ASMR, FTP here. Back with another Magic the Gathering video. I'm in a little bit of bad shape. I tore my tricep playing hockey the other day, and it is all black and blue right now. Getting better. Same time, I am sick. You might hear I don't have any like nasal passage clearance, I guess you could say. My nose is clogged up really bad. Yeah, just general like mild cold symptoms. Nothing terrible, but enough that I just don't feel very well. But it was like a rainy day. I'm not playing hockey, and it's like a nice weekend. You know, I have not much to do, so I decided. And I had some cards on order at the game store. So I just ran to the game store. I didn't stay there long. Obviously, I'm sick. I don't want to get other people sick. I wore my mask. But I just ran in, picked up the cards, and I was like, I'll grab a few packs and record an ASMR video, because I need to do something kind of relaxing and chill for a couple hours. And I know, obviously, that, like, I have an ASMR channel that I can upload to, so might as well do my best to sound and feel good. You know, whispering and talking a lot is not necessarily something you want to do when you're sick, but I'm feeling well enough today that I was like, hey, I'll give it a shot. Yeah, I would show you, like, basically the whole part of my lower right arm is all, like, purple and yellow. It's gross. I don't want to show you, but I got tangled up with somebody and fell on the ice, and my elbow actually hit the ice, and then, like, slid out from, like, basically, like, slid forward, and as it slid forward, like, I could feel the muscle in my tricep, it felt like it got, like, really stretched, and I just felt, like, this very not sharp, right? It was almost like a, it was almost like it was, like, you know, like a Charlie horse, like, when you're really dehydrated, and that, you know, that feeling that really, it's not sharp, but it's, like, a, I don't know, it's really, like, tight. I just felt, like, an extreme tightness in the entirety of my tricep. And I got off the ice. I mean, I was more or less fine, but it really hurt for that night. And then the next two nights, it was pretty painful. Got really swollen, and I was worried, so I saw my doctor. And by the time I had seen my doctor, it was feeling a lot better. It was just red, turning purple and yellow, but it felt fine. And so by the time I saw him, I wasn't worried all that much anymore, but those first two nights I was worried it was going to be something really bad, and I was worried that, like, you know, it might not just be bruising, like, if there's blood clotting. I know blood clots can put strain on your heart. Then I started freaking out about having a heart attack. I'm such a hypochondriac, like, if I don't always think I'm going to get sick or, like, hurt or, like, worst case scenario, but when I start, like, feeling symptoms of something happening, or if, like, you know, like, some sort of injury like that, then I start thinking worst case scenario. So I'm like, I'm a hypochondriac when I'm getting sick, because I guess I don't think of worst case scenario for, like, small stuff, but, you know, for, like, a muscle strain, I was like, oh God, what's gonna happen to me? And it's just a muscle strain, so I'm fine. I just gotta give it. The sad thing is for something as severe as the muscle strain that I have, you know, not all muscle strains even cause bruising or the kind of thing that I'm experiencing. Yeah, like minor muscle strains can take days to recover from, but something more severe like mine that actually has visible, you know, bruising from the actual strain, from the tearing of the muscle, I think is technically what happened. The recovery can be like 4 to 6 weeks. So like with men's league hockey, it's only like 12 weeks of total playtime, and then like the last two, so it's like 12 regular season weeks, and then, well, 12 games, it can be up to like more weeks if you have to skip a week for like a holiday or something, but so missing 4 to 6 weeks, especially at the end when, you know, you're heading towards playoffs, so it's 12 weeks and then 2 extra weeks if you make playoffs, so 14 weeks total, roughly, again, depending on if you have to skip a week or something for a holiday. That's my cat. I gave him catnip and food, and in hopes that he wouldn't disturb me when I try to record, but that never, you know, there's no stopping him. If he hears me recording, he comes by and he starts screaming every time. And if that bothers people, I'm really sorry. I do my best to try to, because I know that that's probably not great ASMR. Wise, but hopefully it's not that disturbing. I'm trying to give him some attention so he can quiet down, but something tells me that won't work. So yeah, it's 12 weeks, 14 with playoffs, so to have the last 4 to 6 weeks potentially that I have to take off means I don't know, like, we have two more games and then playoffs will start. So, like, hey, buddy. yeah, we have two more games, then playoffs will start. So, like, if we win the next, and, like, we're in the playoff hunt, I think we're in, like, second place or something. So, I don't know. Hey, buddy, what do you want? What do you want, buddy? Do you want attention? That's basically, so I'm in a little bit of a bad way, not feeling great, but well enough that I wanted to make a video, so. Give me one sec, I'm just going to stop the recording for Krieger here for a sec. See, this is what I have to deal with every day. He's a menace. He's a menace. Buddy, careful, careful, careful. I have so many wires and stuff around. Come on, buddy. You gotta... Here. Come over here. No. Over here. Come on. There you go. No. He just bonked his head into the camera. And as he walked by, he, like, his tail pulled on the wire. He's such a menace, dude. Oh, no. Stay over here. Good boy. Yeah, lay down. Good boy. Such a good boy. Yeah, he's a menace. Sorry, I just had to start recording again because he was just positioned perfectly right beneath the camera, so I just wanted to show you what I deal with this little guy every day. All up in my business. It's funny because he'll be like, you know, I'll want to hang out with him and he'll be nowhere to be found. And then, you know, like I want me time. I want time where he's not around and he just will not leave me alone. But that's what you sign up for, right? As soon as you decide to take care of an animal, you sign away your rights to privacy, and I literally, like, all privacy. I literally cannot go to the bathroom, or he will stand outside and claw the door, or, you know, like, if I leave the door open, just like a crack, he doesn't really know how to open it, so I'll see his paw, like, just pop in and try to open the door, but he's actually closing it on himself, he gets so frustrated. But yeah, I literally, like, anywhere I go, he's gotta go. He's my little shadow. See if we can. Let's just just off screen getting pets. Otherwise, he's gonna just be a nuisance. Dealing with a hockey injury, dealing with sickness, dealing with Krieger. It's just kind of a gray, miserable Saturday. A lot of rain, and I have a slanted ceiling, or a canted ceiling, like an angular ceiling, so like I can hear the pitter-patter on my roof right now, which is really, really nice. Really relaxing, and so I was just kind of like in a relaxing mood. I watched an episode of Shogun yesterday, and an episode of Tokyo Vice this morning. I was just kind of like in a relaxed mood, listening to the rain, watching a show I liked, having a nice breakfast, chilling with Krieger. And I was like, you know what? I can go pick up those cards. I can grab a couple packs, and I can record a video. So that's where we are. That's kind of what brought. I know you probably don't need a backstory for ASMR video of a guy opening Magic the Gathering packs, but there you go. There's the information you didn't ask for. Need my whole life story for me to open three packs of Lord of the Rings Magic the Gathering cards, but neither here nor there. So I'm doing Magic, or I'm doing Lord of the Rings packs because I don't know, I think it has some pretty pricey cards. You got like Orcish Bowmasters, the One Ring, of course. You've got Orcish Bowmasters, the One Ring, and some other cards like that. So, like, there are pricey cards in here. I have one copy of the One Ring. If I can get more, there is a deck that I want to build in standard, no, not standard, modern, that has four copies of the One Ring. But obviously, a long way away, and that's like a $70 card, so. But. Let's see what we have here. I think this, who is this? Is this Sam? Oh, Elena Gardner. I don't know who that is. Looks like a hobbit. Alright, so we have War Beast of Gorgoroth. Oh, is that, what is it? Grog? No. Fuck, what is the... It's the wolf siege engine. Grog. Grog. No, it's not Grog. What do they call it? It's the battering ram that they bring to the gates of Minas Tirith. Minas Tirith. Fuck. This is gonna kill me. I'm literally gonna look this up. Grosh. Chanting Grosh. Oh man. Minas Tirith Wolf Battering Ram. Grond. That's it, Grond. That's actually it. But anyway, War Beast of Gorgoroth. Oh, or is it the pig? It's probably the pig. It's the pig that's pulling Grond. I don't know. 5 mana, 4, and a red. It's a beast creature. That's a 5/4. Whenever War Beast of Gorgoroth or another creature you control with power 4 or greater dies, amass orcs 2. I was about to say weapon. I've been playing a lot of Final Fantasy Rebirth, so... I have weapons on the mind. Surrounded by orcs. 4 mana, 3, and a blue sorcery. Amass orcs 3, then target player mills X cards, where X is the amassed army's power. Orcish Medicine. 1 and a black. Instant. Target creature gains your choice of lifelink or indestructible until end of turn. Amass orcs 1. Mordor Muster, 1 and a black. So sorcery, you draw a card and you lose one life. Amass orcs one. The Grey Haven's legendary land. When it enters the battlefield, scry one. Tap it to add one colorless mana or generic mana. Add one mana of any color among legendary creatures, creature cards in your graveyard. Glorfindel, Dauntless Rescuer. 3 mana, 2 and a green. Elf Noble, legendary creature. Whenever you scry, choose one, and Glorfindel gets +1/+1 until end of turn. Glorfindel must be blocked this turn if able. Glorfindel can't be blocked by one or more creatures. Glorfindel can't be blocked by more than one creature each combat this turn. I'm gonna blame it on me being sick. I just cannot read. Arwen Undumiel. I didn't know she had a last name. a green and a blue. She's a 2/2. She's an elf noble. Whenever you scry, put a +1/+1 counter on target creature. That's actually sick. 6 mana, 4. A green and a blue scry 2. I'm actually gonna set her aside. That'd be really cool for like a Bant. I don't know. Fuck. Celeborn the Wise. Celeborn the Wise. 4 mana, 3. And a green. Legendary elf noble creature. Whenever you attack with one or more elves, scry one. Whenever you scry, Celeborn the Wise gets +1/+1 until end of turn for each card looked at while scrying this way. I got freaking Mirkwood Bats, full art. 2/3 flying. Whenever you create or sacrifice a token, each player loses one life. It's actually pretty cool. Flame of Anor. Flame of Anor. 3 mana, 1, a blue and a red, instant. Choose one if you control a wizard. As you cast this spell, you may choose 2 instead. Target player draws 2 cards, destroy target artifact. Flame of Anor deals 5 damage to target creature. It's actually pretty cool. Barrow Blade. So this is the, kind of one part of the original books that never really made it into the movies was the Barrow Downs, where Frodo and the hobbits encounter some wights, which I think they're like ancient men, if I remember correctly, but they get essentially these like enchanted blades. And those are kind of the explanation for how Merry and Eowyn, might just be Merry, ends up slaying the Witch King of Angmar. It's because of the Enchanted Blade, so the Barrow Blades that they get. Energy Flux. 3 mana, 2, and a blue. All artifacts gained at the beginning of your upkeep sacrifice this artifact, unless you pay 2. Whoa. That's really good artifact 8. For like a blue, like if you're playing, like blue tends to be the artifact deck, but that'd be interesting if you're playing like blue non-artifacts and you want to hate on artifact decks specifically. Field. The ring tempts you. It's a 4/5. Sam's Desperate Rescue. One black mana sorcery. Return target creature card from your graveyard to your hand. The ring tempts you. Now for Wrath. Now for Ruin. That's awesome. And the Red Dawn. Death. That's awesome. That's a really cool picture. Four mana. I didn't even know this was a card. Four mana, three and a white sorcery. Put a +1/+1 counter on each creature you control. They gain vigilance until end of turn. The ring tempts you. Another Celeborn the Wise. Ooh, Mirror of Galadriel. Yeah, it is the Mirror of Galadriel. Two colorless or two generic mana. Legendary artifact, five. For five mana, tap it. Scry one, then draw a card. This ability costs one less to activate for each legendary creature you control. Legolas, Counter of Kills. Four mana, two, a green and a blue. He's an elf archer. 2/3 with reach. Whenever you scry, if Legolas Counter of Kills is tapped, you may untap it. Do this only once each turn. Whenever a creature an opponent controls dies, put a +1/+1 counter on Legolas Counter of Kills. Or on just Legolas. A full art Oliphant. I mean, this would have been cool when I was playing Living End. I think I bought more of these anyway, though. But hey, a full art Oliphant. Nazgul. If I remember correctly, this card might be worth a couple bucks. It's a 3 mana, Oliphant. 6 mana, 5 and a red. It's a 6/4 elephant creature with trample. Whenever it attacks another target creature, your control gets +2/+0 and gains trample until end of turn. It has mountain cycling 1. Nazgul, 3 mana, 2 and a black. It's a 1/2 with death touch. When it enters the battlefield, the ring tempts you. Whenever the ring tempts you, put a +1/+1 counter on each wraith you control. A deck can have up to 9 cards named the Nazgul. And we have a copy of the Shire. Damn. Mushroom Watchdogs. So these are Farmer Maggot's Watchdogs. That, who was it? Was it Frodo that was really scared of him because they attacked him or chased after him when he was a kid? Or was that Sam or whatever? Mushroom Watchdogs, 1 and a green, dog, 2/2. Sacrifice of food, put a +1/+1 counter on Mushroom Watchdogs. Gains vigilance until end of turn. Activate only as a sorcery. Then we have Mishra's Helix. 5 colorless mana artifacts. It has X and tap, tap X lands. Seems pretty strong. Just tap your opponent's land. I mean, that's pretty expensive, but if you're a big mana deck, you can just, like, tap all your opponent's lands. I mean, in Commander, like, I think people play enough artifacts where, like, I don't know, maybe not, I don't know. Alright, what is this scene? Lighting of the Beacons. Call for aid. Gondor calls for aid. Oops. Forest. Cast into fire. 1 and a red. Choose 1. Cast into fire deals 1 damage to each of up to 2 target creatures. Exile target artifact. I'm putting that aside because I need one of those to fight against the One Ring. Smite the Deathless. 1 and a red. Instant. Smite the... Hey, wow. This is the scene we were just talking about. Eowyn and Merry. Merry using the Barrow Downs thing to kill the Witch King of Angmar. That's actually sick. Smite the Deathless deals 3 damage to target creature. That creature loses indestructible until end of turn. If that creature would die this turn, exile it instead. Battle Scarred Goblin. 1 and a red. Goblin Warrior. When it becomes blocked, deals 1 damage to each creature blocking it. It's a 2/2. A Troll of Khazad-dûm. Another great card if I was playing Living End if I didn't already have 4 copies for Living End. 6 mana, 5 and a black. Can't be blocked except by 3 or more creatures with swamp cycling 1. Lorien Revealed, another. An Island Cycler. 5 mana, 3 and 2 blue. Draw 3 cards, Island Cycling 1. Long List of the Ends. 1 green mana with 6 chapters. each chapter, note a creature type that hasn't been noted for a long list of the ends. When you cast your next creature spell of that type this turn, that creature enters the battlefield with an additional +1/+1 counter on it. Interesting. Entish Restoration. 3 mana, 2, and a green instant. Sacrifice a land, search your library for up to 2 basic land cards, put them onto the battlefield, tap, then shuffle. If you control a creature with power 4 or greater, instant, search your library for up to 3 basic land cards and put them onto the deck. Wow. That's really good. Land Reval, Horizon Witness. 5 mana, 4, and a white. It's a 3/4 with flying. Whenever 2 or more creatures you control attack a player, target attacking creature without flying gains flying until end of turn. Rising of the Day. 3 mana, 2, and a red. Creatures you control have haste. Legendary creatures you control get +1/+1. Ooh, okay. Well, disappointing, but we'll take it. Watcher in the Water. 5 mana, 3, and 2, blue. Legendary Kraken creature. It's a 9/9. Enters the battlefield tapped with 9 stun counters on it. If a permanent with a stun counter would become untapped, remove one from it instead. Whenever you draw a card during your opponent's turn, create a 1/1 blue tentacle creature token. Whenever a tentacle you control dies, untap up to 1 target Kraken and put a stun counter on up to 1 target non-land permanent. The Bath Song. With 4 mana, 3, and a blue. Enchantment Saga. 3 chapters. Chapters 1 and 2, draw 2 cards, then discard a card. Chapter 3, shuffle any number of target cards from your graveyard into your library. Add 2 blue. So Full Art Rising of the Day is pretty cool. Entish Restoration is pretty cool. Watcher in the Water is, like, cool, but I don't know that I'm going to do anything with it. I love having a Lorien revealed. I love Trollocaz of Doom. Pretty interesting, like, random cards we got here. The Mishra's Helix and Energy Flux. Pretty good, like, hate cards. A copy of the Shire is cool. Flame of Anor is cool. Arwen is pretty cool. So, yeah, pretty happy with these. Obviously, they're, you know, none of them are the One Ring, but, you know, I didn't expect with 3 set boosters to get a copy. But, yeah, I don't know, pretty cool pulls. Rising of the Day. I wonder if I already have a copy in my Cranko deck. Entish Restoration seems pretty good for one of my commander decks. Lorien Revealed is just kind of cool. Trollocaz of Doom, cool. And wait, did I not put the Oliphants in here? I mean, the only thing I didn't get was Generosent and what's the white cycle or the Eagles of the North, which, I don't know, of all the cyclers, the classic Magic the Gathering, of a cycle, the white one's the worst. Right, like, what was it, the ward cycles, where, like, white ward, by definition, unequipped itself, because it protected itself from white or whatever, making it by far the worst ward. I think they errated that later. They, like, fixed it so it didn't, you know, protect from itself or whatever. Instant or sorcery in your graveyard flashback. Snapcaster Mage. could run like Snapcaster Mage. You could do like Soulscar Mage and Monastery Swift Spear, I guess, is your early prowess threats. And then like Snapcaster is like a late. You could like recast a Lightning Bolt or, you know, a Flame of Anor or something. Late game. Flame of Anor, it's target player draws 2, destroy target artifact, deals 5 damage to target creature. I mean, 5 damage to a creature is pretty good. That gets rid of pretty much everything in Modern that's relevant. So I made a review of Final Fantasy VII Remake. I still have to do. I honestly might just take the footage from that. And I mean, all I did was I just had some gameplay footage that I just like threw together, and then I talked over that gameplay footage. I might just take that same exact footage and then do an ASMR review for those of you who wanted it. It was like people wanted both. So I am gonna make that ASMR review of Final Fantasy VII Remake. I'm again might just take that same footage and just make an ASMR review instead. I don't know what I'm gonna do for Rebirth. I don't know. The game is long, and I'm at a point where like I can kind of go anywhere and do anything, which makes me think I'm near the end. It's almost like in the original Final Fantasy VII, there was a point where the game opened up right before the end of the game, and you could go anywhere and do anything. Essentially, a Disc 3 was the whole world is open to you. You can go anywhere, do anything, wrap up all the loose ends, and then go fight the final, you know, go to the final spot to fight the final boss. And I feel like I'm kind of at that spot. The whole world has opened up, you know, there are new side quests and stuff. It was kind of like, go and do everything you can, because, you know, once you start on a specific path, that, you know, you're the game is going to start ending or whatever. So I want to kind of go everywhere and do everything I can to, before I go and end the game. That being said, I don't know. Just like Remake, I think people are overestimating, overhyping, and kind of they're giving the game too much credit. You know, anybody, I think I'll put it this way, I'll put it as succinct as I can, or as brief as I can, because obviously I'll leave a more in-depth discussion for the review itself. But anybody, I think, who said that this game is a 10 out of 10, is Game of the Year contender, is the best Final Fantasy game ever made, is so very wrong. It is, I think they're out of their minds. Not in like a literal sense, but in a figured, well, in a literal sense, in that they, I think, are, as I said, giving it too much credit, probably because they have the nostalgia blinders on. I think they value the original too much, and that factored into their evaluation of the game, and it is nowhere near any of those metrics, it does not achieve anything close to any of those statements or expectations, whatever you want to call them. It's not that. It's very, very far from that, in my opinion. It's a good game. Sometimes. So, which is disappointing, to say the least, you know, to wait so long for that game to come out, and it for it to kind of, we'll talk about it, but, yeah, hoping to, you know, I'm still trying to figure out what's going on, as far as recording for, like, gameplay of stuff. Obviously, Final Fantasy VII Rebirth is on my PlayStation, so be a lot better to record stuff on the PlayStation, but I have it downstairs just because, I want it there. I don't want to record it up here, but I could. I don't know. Still trying to figure all that stuff out, so hoping that that gets done soon. Still saving up for that Blue Yeti microphone so that audio quality improves. For those of you who are sticking around and sticking with me through all this, I appreciate you so much. But yeah, thank you everybody who is watching